In 84, you went to Boy State, thereabout.
Several of you did.
And I remember that instead of going to the sessions, you were telling people you were running and exercising, and you would end up in our office. And he would say, I don't want to be over there, you know, and I'm not knocking the program, but I'm just wondering, what made it different? I've known about Boy State. I know it does good work.
Boy State and Girl State.
Yeah. What made it different?
I didn't feel accepted. I didn't feel connected. I didn't want to be a part of that. And even though I knew that there was a very selective program or process that I had gone through to go to that, I felt more connected with NHI, and even though the program wasn't going on, I still knew where your office was, and I just started running.
I started running,
and then I sort of remember where it was, and I turned, and like, yeah, they were dead. And in fact, that's the same road we took today.
Yeah, we just did it a minute ago.
Turned right here.
The red door.
And then for me, it was just, I wanted to connect further.
The only difference, I think, that we're going to take in those areas as we go forward is that the Mexican-American business and professional community will play a larger role financially. Then we will understand more clearly this whole concept of ownership. This is our program. It's for our benefit. Therefore, we should underwrite the majority cost.
We were frightened in the early years of NHI, not really knowing whether it was going to survive. And the moral support that we got from you as volunteers and as individuals, you know, I think today you see the result.
NHI, because of its unique origin, the way that we have not depended on outside sources, you know, on outside support, and it's been painful, not easy, you know, to do it that way, was uniquely equipped to do it, to take those kinds of risks. And I believe that the outcome was worth the risk.
You know, a lot of people ask me, who are your heroes as Latinos? And of course, I always tell them my parents. And you know, a lot of people talk about Cesar Chavez, and Willie Velasquez with the big campaign to get Latinos out to vote. Talk about Raul Izaguirre with the Council of the National Council of La Raza. And I always tell them there's two people in Maxwell, Texas, and I'm getting kind of choked up here, but who are my heroes?
In 97, I'm in an airport in LA waiting for a flight to return to Texas. And after this vacation, I'm with my wife, and we're there, and then I see a few young kids, you know, they're saying goodbye and they're weeping and they're hugging and holding each other. And I'm looking at them, they're in the gate right next to me, and I'm just looking at them, and there's a connection. I can't explain it. I felt what they were feeling. And then I came up to some of them, I said, well, what were y'all doing? And we're in a leadership conference, we just finished it. I said, LDZ, NHI. And they look at me and they said, were you there? And I said, no, but in 84 I did in Texas. And that's when I realized it got national.
We are attempting to cause a shift in a social perspective of a community that has historically been viewed by the dominant culture as simply being in a service role at the lower levels of American society, and for that community to begin to perceive itself as an equity player in policymaking.
If there is an organization, I think it's the National Hispanic Institute, and its alums that are going to face the new world, the constantly changing new world.